Yes, in that way, our teachers can function on Earth.
And what about new ideas, new and novel ideas? Are souls or spirits allowed to bring those or transmit them to people on Earth?
What kind of new ideas?
Oh, just revolutionary ideas, like the invention of electricity.
A lot can come from the human brain and the soul that occupies that brain. It doesn't have to be planted there by a teacher.
But would they?
But they could be.
Okay.
They could be.
Uh-huh.
Or maybe not. Maybe it's just simply coming from the soul itself.
I guess what I'm getting to is, are there rules of interference or not?
I don't find rules.
Okay.
I really don't find rules. It's the sort of thing that you see as a part of the advancement of civilization, and there are ideas that appear that seem very innovative, and sometimes the rest of us don't know where the origin of those ideas come from. You have actually, Kelly, different types of souls too. That I didn't mention this, but you can have souls who are either unable or unwilling to function individually as people on Earth. For example, they usually work within collectives and never seem to leave the spirit world. I mean, it's not that they don't get the opportunity, but there are souls who don't want to incarnate into physical bodies, I've learned. And, of course, the only way I can learn this is from the souls I'm interviewing who know these beings. Because, of course, I can't interview those that aren't incarnating on Earth. Now, there are souls who don't, as I say, wish to incarnate in physical form, and they can work on metal worlds. And they seem to move easily between dimensions. They're souls who incarnate only on physical worlds. They may have the capability for training in mental spheres between lives, but I sense that most of those are not inclined to do so. They're not attracted to interdimensional travel. And quite a number of my clients were in this category. And then you have souls who have a very broad spectrum of abilities. They have both the ability and the desire to function on all types of physical and mental environments. So it doesn't necessarily mean that they have more enlightenment than other souls, but this is what they prefer, and it's the way that they happen to think, and their abilities and so forth play into it, but more often it's their interests and aspirations. So I guess I'm trying to say, Kelly, that there are many opportunities for different kinds of specializations when it comes to activities in the spirit world. There's another type of soul that's kind of interesting, where I find that we have in my practice, I think I ran into about 15% of my clients, perhaps, that were in this category, and that's the hybrid soul. And it's the name I give to souls on Earth today who began their incarnations on other worlds. And you can imagine with all the billions of star systems we have in our universe that there are certainly other worlds that are intelligent worlds. They may not be exactly like Earth, but nonetheless, there is intelligence on other worlds. Now, this is interesting when a soul either wants a different type of challenge and goes to their guide and asks for a transfer, if you will. They can come to Earth that way. Or their world might have gone into Nova and not be in existence anymore for any type of physical being, and so they're reassigned because they have much more work to do, and they may come to Earth. And some of these souls have a very difficult time here. The suicide rate among them in the beginning is rather high for souls that have come from perhaps more gentle worlds, and they start their incarnations here. But I find that once they get over that early trauma of their early lives on Earth, that they can be highly functional and beings on Earth that really make great contributions. They often have very superior brain capacity and even a little ability when it comes to mental telepathy. So, especially if they came from a telepathic world, they tend to have greater psychic abilities, perhaps I could say that, than would be normal. So, as I say, that there's a lot of complex aspects, Kelly, about souls and their life between lives.
Mm-hmm. I understand from your case studies that there's a great deal of preparation that goes on in the spirit world before incarnating, almost like rehearsals for a stage play.
And that's very true. How long depends on every particular, whatever particular client you're working with, their soul. And it's an area that, frankly, I don't know a lot about because they can't report too much as far as their memories. Now, either there's an amnesic block there, or they don't choose to tell me, or they simply have difficulty in relating too much about their life before that first incarnation. But it's a fascinating area.
You mentioned in your book, you talked about the difficulty of the symbiotic relationship between the soul and the human brain.
Yes, this is one of the most important aspects of my studies. Really, Kelly, more than anything else as a psychotherapist, I think my contribution, if you will, in this area was very great, and I've had a lot of people that I've worked with that I want them to continue this aspect of study because, to me, this is an area that can help so many people who are working through their incarnations. And what it basically involves is the duality of the soul. And the when I say duality, I mean the soul mind versus the brain. And you have souls who perhaps don't have a lot of perception about who they really are once they're in a human body. They look in a mirror and they'll say, you know, why am I me? This doesn't seem like the real me. And the reason for that is because of the fact that their physical brain may be quite different than that of their soul brain. You can find cases where souls have a very close symbiotic relationship in that the human brain and the temperament that goes up into that brain from the central nervous system and all of the synapses of the particular mind that we're talking about, there's a kind of a corollary between that and the soul itself. Or it can be in opposition. So, for example, you could have a soul combating a need to control others or fighting self-indulgence. Might be very comfortable in working in conjunction with a brain disposed to, say, a more aggressive behavior and inclined towards self-gratification. But, I mean, I'm not saying that this might not be volatile. There may be very important karmic reasons for that association. But what I find more common is souls who want to work in opposition to the brain in order to gain from the association.
Yeah.
For example, a low-energy, passive soul might want to be with a highly emotional, restless body in order to combat, say, a natural inclination to being fearful and not taking risks. So you've got kind of a mixture here, a push-me-pull-you. But I think what people need to understand, the bottom line here, Kelly, is that in each life, of course, we have a new brain that has a temperament about it, and there's also the character of our soul, the immortal character which changes only very slowly combined with a temperament in the particular brain of the mind it's occupying that may or may not be disposed to, say, towards aggression or passivity or whatever. And the two combined bring us into one personality in one lifetime. So a lot of times, people are very confused about who they are. And it's incredible that in 1 3-hour session, they can learn so much about their true identity that it puts 10 years of working with a psychiatrist to shame. I mean, I'm taking nothing away from psychologists and psychiatrists. I was a psychologist. But what you can uncover in 3 hours of therapy with a skilled facilitator,